Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much for inviting me to give these lectures. Since you didn't remind it, I'm proudly saying that I contributed founding. I was a co-founder of this school, and so I'm really happy to see that it's running so well, and also that I'm very happy to be here trying to contribute with these lectures about collider physics. So maybe you would expect me to start from trying to explain you what is collider physics, but in fact the purpose of the entire series of lecture is to give you a set of elements that hopefully will define for me and for you what is collider physics. So I will in fact try to give you my view on what is collider physics at the very last lecture, based on these elements that I will put on this blackboard in the course of the course. However, it's important to make some disclaimer and some word of context. Collider physics is an extremely broad topic, and if you randomly pick up some expert of collider physics and you ask teaching collider physics, depending also on the environment and the context, you will get completely different lectures. So there is an entire universe of scientists who work on the collider itself. The collider, the device that provides the collision between the particles, that is the one that we want to study as physicists and theorists in particular, is an extremely complex and beautiful application of classical and not only electromagnetism that is studied by theorists as well. There are accelerator physics theorists and theorists who are doing fantastic type of things that especially us, I think, as theorists find super exciting. There is technology. There is an entire community that is working on the magnets that are essential components of colliders. And so these people will give lectures that will speak about the technology that is behind a collider. And then, of course, there are the experimentalists who are also a huge community that deals with recording and processing and interpreting the data that comes from these collisions, that deal with the physics design and also engineering of the detector that undergoes and that is needed in order to record these collisions. And inside all this big community, there is a small community which is theorists and phenomenologists like we are. And so the concise overview of a few topics of collider physics I will give you is in fact very strictly and with very few excursions in the other fields. The vast majority of what I'm going to tell you is really about theory and phenomenology of collider particles. So what do we learn? How we make predictions for these colliders? That, however, is a topic that cannot be appreciated fully, okay, if you want to work on it seriously, without a broader view on what the others do and how this is interfaced with the physics, which is only one, the same physics that we want to extract and get out of these colliders. So the lecture is organized, so the course is organized in five chapters that correspond to more or less to the five lectures. Then we will see how fast or slowly I go and where do I really get. And we start from chapter one, of course. I'm very happy of the titles I gave to these chapters. It's the best that you're going to get. So this title is Particles, are spinors. So, in practical terms, what I want to start with in this in this first lecture is to introduce some basic kinematics and also some basic formulas and equations that I will use to do calculations in the rest of this in the rest of the of the course. And I'm going to assume that you know Feynman diagrams. I'm going to assume that you have been exposed basically to the calculation of simple scattering amplitudes. I also assume that if some of these assumptions is wrong, okay, you ask me a question and you can come and see me later. Okay? But what I cannot assume is that you have been exposed to the following, to the explicit form, okay, explicit form of the wave function factors. So a very simple thing that you surely have learned is that when you have external particles in Feynman diagrams, those have to be included by certain factors, wave function factors, which are called the U spinor for Dirac particles, the V spinor for Dirac antiparticles, and we typically call epsilon the polarization vectors that correspond to spin one particles. Okay. The practical goal of this lecture is to derive, several possible explicit forms for these wave function factors, and to write them in a way that is, please. That's right. That's right. These objects are typically not written explicitly in university classes, and very often are not written in the language that I'm going to use, which is the language of spinors. Okay, written. Okay, so this is a practical reason for this lecture. There is also a more philosophical reason, which is that I want to make sure, we all know what is a particle. Okay. And well, in particular in this lecture, what is a single particle state? And and at the end of the lecture, we will be led to conclude that particles are in fact spinors. Okay. Interestingly enough, when we will go through the lectures, we will be led, in fact, to have some doubt on this conclusion of whether physical particles are really single particle states, are really spinors, and to what extent this is really true. Okay. Right. So, by the way, this goes very well along the amplitude course that you're going to have already in the afternoon. I am completely sure that my notation will be different from the one of that course, 100% sure, right? So this will be an opportunity for you to practice and changing from one convention to the other, and you will have fun. In fact, my notations are taken from a book, which is called Scattering Amplitudes. In Gauge Theory and Gravity. That's where I take my notation from. Okay, so starting point, if we want to speak about particles and spinors, given that particles are representations of the Poincaré group, so the starting point is for sure the Lorentz group. And the Lorentz group is SL to C. That means the matrices with the unit determinant, okay, special, 2 by 2 matrices with complex entries. So an element of the Lorentz group then will be denoted by a 2 by 2 matrix lambda. So when I speak of a Lorentz transformation, you have to, have in mind it to be represented in the defining representation by a 2 by 2 matrix lambda, which is Lorentz transformation. This matrix is completely generic, apart from the fact that it has determinant equal to 1. Okay. So the algebra of the Lorentz group is immediately worked out as follows. Let's take an infinitesimal transformation of SL to C, so infinitesimally close to the identity, which means I minus I epsilon t. So given that determinant of lambda is equal to 1, I have that 1 is equal to determinant of lambda, which is equal to lambda 1, 1, lambda 2, 2, minus lambda 1, 2, lambda 2, 1. And so if I am infinitesimally close to the identity, I have to expand 1 plus something in the diagonal entry, while this is over the epsilon square. And so I get 1 minus I epsilon t11 plus t22 plus order epsilon square. And so if I want that the determinant is equal to 1, at this order I just have to ask that t11 plus t22 is equal to 0, which means that the trace of the generator matrix T must be equal to 0. So the algebra of SL to C is made of generic complex matrices with 0 trace, right? So the algebra is span by 6 generators. And which I'm going to take to be like this. So sigma are the regular Pauli matrices, okay? Then I'm gonna need 6 generators to parameterize the most general traceless complex matrix, because I remind you that when we define the basis in the algebra of a Lie group, so a Lie algebra, we need to be able to parameterize the most general, in this case, traceless matrix using only real coefficients. Right? So you may think that you just need 3 generators, because a generic traceless matrix can be written as a complex combination of the 3 sigma matrices, but that's not enough, because those are complex coefficients. You have to isolate the real and the imaginary part, and that's why you have 6 generators. These 6 generators can be taken just proportional to the Pauli matrices, in particular these first 3, which are corresponding then to the subgroup of rotations. Inside SL to C, inside the Lorentz group, are just represented by the usual, two representation or spin 1/2 representation matrices of SU2. These other one, as I said, are proportional to this first one, but with a complex or with the complex coefficient. That's why they are independent as element of the Lie algebra, and they correspond to the boosts. to the three boosts that we know we have on top of the three rotations inside the Poincaré group. Okay. So this this series of six generators offers a faithful representation of the Poincaré group, and so it can be used, for instance, if you like, to derive the commutation relations, to derive the algebra, the commutation relation that define the algebra of the Lorentz group. For example, you can check that commutator of two rotations obeys the regular SU2 algebra. Okay. You can check that, I don't know, commutator between J, A, and K is I, epsilon, I, J, K, 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 and so on. Using, if you want, this 2x2 representation as the defining representation of the Lorentz group. Okay. Okay, so representations of the Lorentz group. From this viewpoint, we have the smallest representation, the defining representation. It's also called the spinor representation. Sometimes I also call it the Weyl representation. It is generated just by that matrix above there. Okay, so this cal J and cal K are the generators of the spinor representation or the Weyl representation of the Lorentz group, which means, and they are represented, these indices in this representation are represented as Greek and lower indices alpha. And so when you see an object with an index alpha, it means that under SL2C, it just transforms by lambda matrix multiplication like this. Okay, where lambda is literally one of these SL2C matrices. So if you want to write, you can write the most general lambda, if you like, as the exponential of minus I phi I j I, where these phi I are rotation angles. So we have three rotations around each of the three directions, right? And then you have the boosts, which you can parameterize in terms of some parameters. Zeta I, okay, cal kappa I, and you have three boosts along the three axis, 1, 2, and 3. This zeta, so these are rotation angles, these are, let's say, boost rapidities. And if you are not sure of what is the rapidity of the boost, it will become more clear in a second. Okay. Right. So, the spinor representation, or Weyl representation, is here. Then you have the anti-spinor. Or if you want, anti-Weyl. And this is just the complex representation. Okay, just the complex conjugate representation. So of this one. So it's represented with a lower index with a dot on top, like alpha dot. And since it's just a complex representation, the way the group acts is just by the conjugate of the lambda matrices. So lambda star, alpha dot, beta dot. We typically put a bar, but just, I mean, what matters is the index, not this bar on top of the anti-spinor. Beta dot, or if you want, chi bar beta dot lambda dagger beta dot alpha dot. Okay. anti-spin representation. And maybe I can write down here also the generator matrices that correspond to this anti-Weyl representation. So the Weyl generators are this one. The anti-Weyl are just minus the Hermitian conjugate of these matrices, because these are the generators of the complex conjugate representation. And so we have, I don't know, J bar I, which is minus 1/2 sigma I star, which is also equal to sigma 2, 1/2 sigma I, sigma 2, and K bar I, that is this time, so minus, but in fact it becomes plus because there is an I, so my again minus I over 2 sigma I star, which is now minus sigma 2 minus I over 2 sigma I, and here there is another sigma 2. Okay. So the anti-Weyl representation has generators which are different, okay, and which are not equivalent to the generator of the two representation. Specifically, the generators of SU2, which is inside, which is the rotation group, are of course equivalent, right? There is a similarity transformation S2, which makes the J bar be equal to the J, right? Okay, that's the usual thing, that in SU2, the two bar is equivalent to the two representation. And the anti-spinner generators are in the conjugate 2 representation of SU2, equivalent to the other one, but are in different representation. And instead, the boost are related by sigma 2 transformation, but there is a minus sign of mismatch, okay? Which means that the 2 and the 2 bar are not equivalent representation in the case of SU2, in the case of SL2C. Oh, maybe I can just mention what is the most general representation. The most general linear and finite dimensional representation of SL2C is made of tensors with an arbitrary number of undotted and dotted indices, okay, and which is completely symmetric both in the dotted and in the undotted indices. Okay, if you look, for instance, on the Weinberg book, there is a very simple proof of this fact. Okay, it's extremely simple. It essentially has to do with the fact that the algebra of SL2C can be viewed in some sense as the algebra of the product of two SU2s. Okay. Ah, sorry. Finally, the invariant tensors. That is to say, the object that we can use to make invariant contractions are only the epsilon tensor, so anti-symmetric tensor with either two undotted indices or with two dotted indices. Okay, so these are invariant tensors, and invariant contractions can be made with anti-symmetric tensors with the upper indices, like this. And well, maybe I can specify the convention that epsilon 1, 2 is equal to minus 1, while epsilon 1, 2 up is equal to plus 1. Okay. So we will need only one other type of representation, which is the vector. It's called the vector because it's a representation where Lorentz four vectors, regular Lorentz four vectors, live. For example, the P momentum, the P mu momentum, is in this representation. But in fact, from the viewpoint of at least from this viewpoint on the Lorentz group, this vector representation is in fact formed by 2x2 matrices. So if I want to describe a four momentum, I will in fact write P alpha alpha dot with one undotted and one dotted index. And so this means that under the SL2C, this transforms by multiplication with the lambda matrix, so lambda alpha beta on this index here, and with the star of the lambda matrix, so lambda star alpha dot beta dot P alpha P beta beta dot. Okay. And this is the way in which the four momentum transforms. Furthermore, the four momentum is a real vector, which means that its entries are subject to this condition, P alpha alpha dot equal to P alpha dot alpha star. Or if you want to call this P to represent it as a matrix, then this just means that P Hermitian conjugate is equal to P, P dagger equal to P. Okay. So given that get P is an Hermitian matrix, okay, it has then four real components. And that's why, well, it is associated with the four momentum, which is in fact the four momentum of a particle has four real entries. To make the transition between the mu Lorentz notation and this one, you have to write this equation. So P matrix is equal to P mu sigma mu, where sigma mu is made of the identity and of the three Pauli matrices. Or explicitly, P is equal to P naught times sigma naught, which is the identity, minus P I sigma I, which is equal to P0 minus P3, okay, in the first entry. And this one, we're gonna call it P minus. Okay, P0 minus P3 is called P minus. Then we have the diagonal entry on the other side, which comes from the identity here and the sigma 3 there, and it's then P naught plus P3. And this one combination of energy, P0, and third component of the momentum, we are going to call it P plus. And then the off diagonal pieces, so they are here. I do have P1, so the momentum along the x axis, minus I P2 with a minus sign in front. And I'm going to call P1 minus I P2, I'm going to call it, so this is going to call it minus. PT, okay? P transverse conjugate, okay? And here I have minus P1 plus I P2, which is minus the complex transverse momentum. Okay? Okay. Okay, so first, this is the first place in which we start encountering things which are a bit specific of collider physics. In fact, these coordinates that you see defined up here are very much used in collider physics for a very simple reason, that there is a special direction in collider physics, that is the direction of the beams that are colliding. This direction is called the three direction, or the z-axis. And these coordinates, you see, they single out one of the three space coordinates with respect to the others. We have defined P plus and P minus with respect to one choice of one axis, which is the three axis. And that's a very useful thing to do in collider physics, where you have the z-axis, or if you want, the three direction, which is the direction of the beam. So you will have one of the two beams that comes from the left, the other beam that comes from the right. This is the z-axis, or the three-axis, and these coordinates, okay, are called light cone coordinates with respect to this specific third axis. And since this axis is very special, this is a smart choice. So if I'm aligning with the third axis around the beam, this is the collision point, then the transverse momentum, Pt, which we always speak about in collider physics, is in fact that object here. Sometimes we say that Pt is a two vector with entries P1 or Px, P1 and P2. And sometimes we put them together in a complex number, like in this Pt, which is defined as P1 plus IP2. Okay? And so we like using Pt, and we also, because it's orthogonal to the beam, and we also like to use P plus and P minus. One of the reasons why we like so much to use P plus and P minus can be understood if we perform a Lorentz transformation that corresponds to a boost along the z-axis, which is the axis of the beam. So how do I do this boost? Well, this boost, we say it corresponds to a lambda matrix that is e to the minus I zeta kappa 3. So kappa 3 is this generator matrix here. If I exponentiate it, I find e to the minus zeta over 2, 0, 0, e to the zeta over 2. So it's diagonal, okay? And it has this simple form e to the minus zeta e to the plus zeta, and the P momentum matrix transforms as lambda P lambda dagger under this transformation. And so this means that, the 1-1 entry will just be multiplied by e to the minus z over 2, two times. So this will give e to the minus zeta over 2 times 2, so e to the minus zeta times P minus. The 2-2 entry would be multiplied by e to the plus zeta, P plus, and the off-diagonal will not change, right? So we will get here minus PT bar, and here minus PT. And so that's saying that under the boost along the z-axis, what's happening is that the transverse momentum does not change, right? And that's clear why, because if I make a boost, the momentum component orthogonal to the boost direction do not change, right? But also this smart light cone combination of coordinates, P plus and P minus, they transform in a very simple way. So what we see here is that P plus minus transforms just by a rescaling with plus or minus the exponential of the boost rapidity. While PT does not change. Okay? This little result here also gives us the opportunity to clarify what is the rapidity, in case the rapidity of a boost, in case you are not familiar with this notion. So if you change coordinates from P plus minus and P0 and P3, from this simple formula you can work out how P0 and P3 then transform under this boost along the z-axis. The transformation, of course, is not going to be simple. P0 is going to be mixed with P3, as boosts typically do. You will find the hyperbolic cosine of zeta, the hyperbolic sine, hyperbolic cosine, acting on P0 and P3. Right? And you can check that this is equivalent to a regular Lorentz transformation that you maybe are used to writing with the beta, boost velocity, if you identify beta to be the hyperbolic tangent of xi. Right? So that's how the boost rapidity is defined with respect to beta. So some more definition of kinematics that we use in collider physics of kinematical variables. So P plus and P minus transform very simply, but there is a combination of them that transforms even simpler than that, which is the rapidity. Again, it's called again rapidity, but in this case it's the rapidity of a particle. In fact, this, eta, and this is 1/2 the natural logarithm of P plus divided by P minus. So P plus and P minus pick up this exponential rescaling factor, e to the zeta, e to the minus zeta. If you divide them, you just pick e to the 2 zeta, you take the log and 1/2. So this transforms just as a shift under boost along the z-axis. And so this is rather convenient. And for this reason, in collider physics, we often use, in order to represent the momentum of a particle, we use either that matrix form or a form in terms of P plus, P minus, PT, or even more commonly, we just specify the rapidity of the particle. It's PT. And then we can infer the last missing component from the mass of the particle that we typically know what it is because we know the species of the particle. Okay? And the mass, if you want, is related to these variables as follows. The mass is P square, which is P0 square minus P. We typically, all right, let's write it as P3 square minus P 1 squared minus p2 squared. P0 squared minus p3 squared obviously is equal to p plus times p minus, because p plus and p minus are just p0 plus or minus p3. So this is p plus p minus. And this is just the norm of the two-dimensional transverse momentum, so minus pt modulo square, which we notice in passing that it's also equal to the determinant of the 2x2 matrix P. And then if I want to use, I don't know, just rapidity, pt, and mass to describe the particle, I can invert this relation, find, for example, that p plus minus is equal to square root of m square plus pt modulo square e to the plus or minus the rapidity eta. Okay? Very last kinematical notion is the pseudo rapidity. So the pseudo rapidity is defined like the rapidity would be if the particle had zero mass. Let's call it eta bar. It's going to be 1/2. The log of, now normally I have p plus divided by p minus, which means energy plus p3 or energy divided minus p3, but instead of the energy here I put the norm of the three momentum p plus p3 What is the reason of this definition? If the particle is massless, it coincides with the rapidity. If the particle is massive, it does not coincide, and then it does not transform, let's say, simply under the Lorentz group. But the reason for this definition is that it's in one-to-one correspondence with the angle of the particle. Right, because the p3 is like the modulus of p times the cosine of theta. Theta is also this is the z-axis. This is the direction of the particle. P and theta is the polar angle with respect to the z-axis, just the angle between the z-axis and the particle. And the rapidity is, as you see, is in one-to-one correspondence with theta. So you can also, we often write it as minus the logarithm of the tangent of theta over 2. Okay. Okay. So collider physicists typically do not say the angle in radians or nothing else; they say it in etas. So eta equal to 0 means theta equal to pi over 2, means that the particle is going orthogonal to the beam, okay? And this is more rapidity, the central region. The region along, say, beam 1, so positive z, means rapidity that goes at some point to infinity when theta is equal to 0, okay? Or to minus infinity where theta is equal to pi, okay? And so sometimes you will hear me saying central or forward or backward, depending on the positive, negative, or nearly zero value of this parameter, which is so it's an important language. Okay. Right. Maybe I can keep this. Okay, so after this background in notation about the Lorentz group and kinematics, let's go to the point of to one of the major points of this lecture, which is the characterizing the single particle states. So single particle states are quantum mechanical states, states in the Hilbert space that describe one single particle, okay? That is to say, that describe, that are completely specified, that are fully labeled as quantum mechanical states by the value of the four momentum, okay, of the particle. And this four momentum has to fulfill a certain condition. P square has to be equal to m square. M square defines the particle that we are looking at. Each particle has only one mass. And of course, then also the energy of this four momentum should be positive for this to be a physical particle. So the single particle states are eigenvalues, if you want, of the P mu operator. Eigenstates of the P mu operator, and they are characterized by the P mu four momentum, and they are also characterized by discrete labels. Okay, so this discrete label is going to be called H in what follows. H is the helicity. In order to describe this system, we start from the single particle state at rest. Which means that the momentum matrix P, right, as written over there, is just proportional to the identity, and in particular it is so P, which is P mu sigma mu, is equal to M times the identity. Okay? So this is the momentum, this is the system I want to study first, the case in which the particle has no velocity. I will only discuss massive particles, and I will comment at the end how to take the Massel's limit, about the Massel's limit. So this is a massive particle, which is at rest. And so its P matrix is M times the identity. And so the state in question, right, is characterized. So it has a fixed momentum. So P mu is P mu. We label the state with P mu equal to M times the identity. And then it has H discrete indices. Okay, that's what the particle is. We are in the rest frame, so the momentum is fixed to be M times the identity. And so in this frame, the particle is simply labeled by this discrete index A. What this means? Well, it means that if I consider a rotation, so I pick up a special set of Lorentz transformation, which are rotations. And as we say, those are something like e to the minus I phi I j I. This rotation is going to act on my state as follows. So U of R means here the representation on the Hilbert space, okay, of this element of the rotation group. So if you want U of R will be the exponential of e to the minus I phi I, the same phi I times j I, capital J I, that is the operator that is acting on the Hilbert space and that corresponds to that same rotation as this one, right? Acting on M I. So particles must form representation of the entire Poincaré group. So in particular here, they must form a representation of the rotation group, because if I act with the rotation, right, on the momentum, given that the momentum is at rest, it doesn't change. remember the P here, right? The P matrix transforms as lambda P lambda dagger. And so if lambda is a rotation, okay, lambda equal to R, this is just, and P is equal to proportional to the identity, this is just M times R dagger R, which is equal to M, which is equal to P. Okay? So the four momentum of the particle does not change if I perform this rotation. And so what needs to happen is that if I perform this rotation, my state goes into a linear combination of states at rest. So with momentum mi, index sum over g. And here, I'm going to have, I need to have some representation matrix of the rotation group, right? So this set of states with respect to the index A, they must form of the representation of the rotations. And we have, and we know already from basic SU2 knowledge what these representation matrices could be, okay? These representation matrices can be, must be some representation matrix that corresponds to a spin S. That's the most general thing that they can be, and a particle is defined, the spin of a particle is defined relative to what is the spin of this matrix. Okay. Right? Right. So the let me discuss 1 second of the meaning of this H label, which I call the helicity. So if I look at the state in the center of mass frame where this equation holds, then it's clear what is the interpretation of H. It is the third component of the spin, okay? Why it is clear? Because if I now consider an infinitesimal rotation along the third axis, okay, this is the identity. So this is so this gives mi h minus I phi 3 j 3, right? And this is okay, so that equation defines exactly how the J generator, in this case the J3 generator, is acting on the state, and it's acting through the standard spin S generator matrices, really the ones that you find in the in textbooks in quantum mechanics. Okay, and these matrices are designed in such a way to have a diagonal third generator with the eigenvalue which is precisely equal to the helicity H. Okay. So this gives minus I phi h mi h, okay? Which means so the label I'm calling helicity in the center of mass frame directly corresponds to the eigenvalue of the third component of the angular momentum. So in this frame, so when the particle is at rest, the ellicity is the third component of the spin, okay? So there is this identification. Then what this ellicity label corresponds to in a frame where the particle is not at rest, it does depend on the definition of the states outside the center of mass, as I will briefly comment about this in a second. Okay, probably we can keep this equation here. And let's finally go to the calculation that we wanted to do as an outcome of this lecture, which is the wave function factors. So this is one of the things that you can ask me privately also, if you prefer, if you're not sure why. But these wave function factors, the things that have to be put in correspondence with the external on-shell incoming or outgoing particles, are the following matrix elements between the vacuum, the field that interpolates the particle under consideration, and the state. The field evaluated in, well, the position which is conventionally taken to be x equal to 0. Everybody knows where this is coming from? So in the simplest approach to quantum field theory, you expand the field in modes, right? You have the field expansion in modes, and when you compute a Feynman diagram, what is left, right? When you do the S matrix, is precisely this factor, which corresponds to the overlap between the field and the state. Okay? If you want a more elaborate explanation, I can give this to you maybe privately. So wave function factors, let's compute them. So of course, we are going to compute first the factors for the particles at rest. So and we start from a particle of spin 1/2. So the particle has spin 1/2. So the field that we use to describe this particle will be a Dirac field. And the Dirac field has two components. One of these components is a Weyl field. So the first case I want to consider is the one in which the psi field has a Weyl index alpha and interpolates for a particle at rest. This particle is going to have spin equal to 1/2. Okay. So I want to show you, I want to convince you that this matrix element is completely determined by symmetries up to one overall constant that, however, I will not determine for you. So the reason is that this field has a specific alpha index. It's a Weyl fermion. And so we know how it transforms under Lorentz transformation. So we know how it transforms under rotation. Under rotation, a Weyl spin is in the two representation, as we saw before, right? This one guy here is going to be, again, in the two representation because it's a particle of spin 1/2 and because we declared here how the states at rest transform under rotation, right? If you want to see this explicitly, you can do the usual trick in which you add here a rotation and the inverse of this rotation. You put it one here, and acting on the vacuum, it does nothing. You put another one here, And then you pick up the action of this U dagger on this state here, according to that formula over there. And then you you use the fact that you know how the rotations, the entire Lorentz group, in fact, but the rotations in particular act on a state, on a field with one alpha index. The field is at zero, so there is no effect on the rotation on the coordinate because the coordinate is at zero. And so if you do this trick, you can find out that this one that is to say, this object has an index alpha and an index h. If you act on the rotation, you see that the rotations act with this rotation matrix here on the alpha index, that becomes beta, and they act with this R dagger, so the conjugate rotation on the index g, which corresponds to the fact that this state is in the two representation like this one. And so this means that by symmetries, by rotation symmetries, this matrix element that defines the wave function must stay the same. Here I have an equality if I perform a rotation on this index and on this index as well. So it must be an invariant tensor of SU2 with one index, with the two indices, with one index in the two and the other, in fact, in the two bar representation. And this determines completely the form of this state. There is only one invariant tensor in the two bar, which is delta, which is the identity in the space H alpha. And so I can write the result for the wave function with the state helicity H interpolated by Weyl alpha at rest for spin 1/2. I have something which is proportional to delta alpha h with a factor. I will now justify briefly with a factor of square root of m, where m is the mass of the particle. And I'm going to call this thing, I'm going to give a name, V alpha h, to this thing. That is to say, I'm going to define two spinors or a B spinor. So V alpha plus, V alpha minus. V alpha plus is square root of m 0. V alpha minus is 0 square root of m. By the way, there is a very useful exercise that I will assign you, and those who want to understand things well can redo all this calculation in a guided form. But so the logic here is that by symmetries, we can constrain the form of that matrix element, which is our wave function factor. The symmetry is just the rotation symmetry. And this is the result that you get. Okay? Then, for reason that will become clear in a second, I'm expressing this result in terms of these two V spinor objects. One thing in the result that you cannot check is the normalization, the square root of m. Of course, it comes from two things. From the fact that I am willing to consider a state that is normalized. So the state should be normalized, which means something like I'm using the regular relativistic normalization, PP prime, 2 pi cube, delta 3 of p minus p prime times twice the energy. Okay? Well, this is something that I'm using. And I'm also using the fact that the field that interpolates the state is canonically normalized. If you remember quantum field theory classes, this means that its propagator is just the standard one. For example, a Dirac has I over P slash minus M and not twice I over P slash minus M. Okay? So if you put together these elements, you can in fact compute also the numerical factor in front of here, but that's not, I mean, that's not what, what is interesting. What is interesting, well, it's also interesting, but this is not what I'm gonna do. I just want to convince you why there is need of this square root of M, okay? Which is a very important factor, especially if you go in the massless limit. There is need of the square root of M by dimensional analysis because the psi field, fermion fields, have a dimension of 3/2, okay? The vacuum is dimensionless. I'm talking about energy dimensions, of course, the only ones that are relevant in particle physics. Well, not all. And the dimension of a single particle state, you can easily check that is equal to minus one. You can check it from this equation here, okay? Take the norm and you see that it must comply. And so then this means that the wave function factor written over there, it's vacuum psi state, okay? Must have a dimension of 3/2 minus one, which is 1/2, okay? And here, in fact, I find square root of m. Why m? Because it's the only scale, because the particle is at rest. There could not have been anything else. Okay. I can follow the same logic if I, sorry for erasing so fast. I can follow exactly the same logic if I want to compute the wave function factor associated with the same particle, okay, of, well, of course, at rest, and h, and spin 1/2. But from an interpolating field, which is an antiviral, so psi bar alpha dot at 0. The result will be slightly different because now this alpha dot under rotation does not transform in the 2, but in the 2 bar, okay? And if you want, there is an epsilon tensor in between. But again, there is only one invariant of rotation that I can form with spin 1/2, spin 1/2. It just is written in a slightly different form. So the result is still unique. And I'm gonna write this result in V bar H alpha dot, where I found useful to define V bar A alpha dot. So this is gonna be minus epsilon A B V B alpha dot star and V bar plus alpha dot is equal to 0 square root of m, and V bar minus alpha dot is equal to minus square root of m, 0. Okay? So once again, what I've done here, I've used the rotation symmetries in order to characterize what is the most general form this structure can have up to a constant, and I fixed the constant from your viewpoint, arbitrary way, but it comes from studying properly the normalization of the state and of the field. And I found convenient to re-express this in terms of another type of spinor, of B spinor, which is called bar, V bar. This V bar is not different, so it's not gonna be a new degree of freedom, but it's gonna be related with V. So it's gonna be, in fact, minus the star of the epsilon tensor, the antisymmetric tensor, acting on the B index, which can be plus or minus, like here. And if you can check that this equation corresponds to these explicit expressions for V bar plus and V bar minus. Okay. So this allows me to start writing down the final formulas. Start, not finish yet. The final formulas that we will need to to retain. So, right. So, we often work using a Dirac field. A Dirac field is a four-component field. It's not an irreducible representation of this L2C group. It's made of two blocks, which with different representations under the Poincaré, under the Lorentz group. The upper component is a vial with index alpha. The lower component, denoted with a bar, is a non-tivial with upper index. Okay, or the epsilon, so it's the epsilon, some epsilon acting on a lower index anti-vial. And so now if I want to compute the U spinor, okay, the U spinor, which is the matrix element between the vacuum and the Dirac field and my state, right, I just have to take the matrix element of a vial, the matrix element of an anti-vial, as computed there, and put them together. So the result is that UH, we call it UH, is equal to B, H. H can be plus or minus, and in this case is associated with the helicity of the state. And here I have V bar H, alpha dot. I can make a similar calculation in the case of antiparticles. So the fact here is that we like to use the conjugate, okay, of the Dirac field to create from the vacuum a different type of particles. That is to say, the Dirac field is a complex field, so there is some type of particles that it can create from the vacuum, okay, and there is the opposite type of particles, the antiparticles, which the dagger of the Psi field can create. And so we do have to compute also things like the Dirac dagger MI H for the antiparticles, while this is for the particles. Okay. So this matrix element, for practical reasons, it's called V star. So it's the conjugate of the V spinor that you find in books, and the reason being that we want V star to be used for the annihilation of a particle, and V for its creation. So V star is, by the same logic, V bar H alpha dot V H alpha, that is to say epsilon alpha beta V beta H. The last wave function we need is the one for vector. So I'm gonna consider a field with index alpha, alpha dot, that is related with the regular vector field V mu, like this. So this is the way I like to express vector fields. Then, in this notation, the polarization vectors epsilon are a matrix, epsilon mu alpha alpha dot, And again, I'm considering a particle at rest with some helicity h, right? And this is going to be the matrix element of V alpha alpha dot times the state. Okay. How do things work here? Well, the state that I'm referring to now, of course, doesn't have spin 1 half. That cannot be interpolated from the vacuum by a vector. It has a spin equal to 1. So I have here a spin 1 representation of the rotation group. Remember the usual trick. I'm in the rest frame. I can make a rotation without changing the momentum. And so this needs to be an invariant tensor with respect to rotation. With which indices? There is this h, which is in a spin 1, right? And there is alpha and alpha dot, which are in the 2 or 2 bar representation. Okay? There is only one singlet in the tensor decomposition of 2 times 2 times 1. And this corresponds to the one single invariant tensor that you have here. So once again, it's completely fixed by rotational symmetry, what is this matrix element up to an overall constant. Okay? It's more tricky than the other cases. And I think you should try as an exercise to, it's quantum mechanics, in fact. It's the type of exercise that you do in quantum mechanics, only in a slightly different context. To work out what is the form of this epsilon thing, so epsilon h alpha alpha dot mi is like this, is square root of 2, v. The same V's, right, that we defined before, VA1 alpha, V bar alpha dot A2. An important factor of 1 over M times symmetric tensors, tau. If you remember the SU2 spin decomposition, right? The decomposition of, so if you want to express a spin 1 representation into spin 1 half, that's conveniently done in terms of symmetric tensors, if you remember quantum mechanics. And that's why these symmetric tensors end up here. For each helicity, you have a different tensors. And notice here there is a sum over A, which is plus or minus, which corresponds to the two entries of that B spinor over there. Okay. And these tensors have a simple form. So the tensor for h equal to 1 is given by 1, 0, 0, 0. Only the up component, which is the one that has spin up, and so it can make a spin 1 plus, right? The tau tensor that corresponds to helicity minus 1 is 0, 0, 0, 1, all down things. And the tau tensor that corresponds to helicity 0 is 0, 1 over square root of 2, 1 over square root of 2, 0. Instead, it has entries which are off diagonal, so one spin is up and the other spin is down, because this total spin must be 0, which corresponds to the helicity equal to 0. Okay? The 1 over m, okay, here there is 1 over m. Remember, I reabsorbed a V inside V. There is already an M reabsorbed. And that's why there is a 1 over M in front of there. OK? Again, it comes from dimensional analysis. It comes from the fact that now I'm taking the matrix element as before, but of a state, which is a bosonic field, a vector field, which has a dimension 1 and not 3 half. OK? So dimension 1, dimension minus 1, this must be dimensionless. And since I decide to put the mass inside the V-spinor, there's going to be 1 over mass in front of here. Okay? This is very robust and also very important when you consider the massless limit of all this construction, no? Right. Okay. Yes. Let me introduce the hosts. That's fine. Okay. This. Let me introduce a very last bit of notation. So it's convenient to do the following. If you see a spinor, these V are spinors, right? A spinor V alpha, okay, which can have B spinor index A, again, plus or minus, and so some object like this, you may want to denote it with a ket, okay, with a squared bracket here, such that when you see this, there is some lower alpha index always, okay? When you see something like V with index A, but alpha upper, then it can be useful to think to this as a bra of the same type. Okay, so if you will see a formula like this, it will mean that there is an alpha index up. Okay, it's defined to be equal to this, in fact. It works somehow the opposite way for the angular brackets, and so you have that V A angular brackets are associated with V bar. V bar is not independent. It's just given by V through this formula. But if we have V bar, instead of writing V bar, we can write something like V with this little angular bracket. But take into account that, at least in the notation that I'm following, this means V bar with upper alpha dot index, while this type of ket was with lower. So there is a flipping from here to here. Alpha bar, so alpha dot. While, yes, there is also an A. And then like this, we have V bar A alpha dot. A stays always up, right? You can raise and lower this A, in fact, with epsilon, but you don't need to do so. Okay? A remains always up. And it's explicitly labeled inside the bra or inside the ket. Explicitly reported inside the bra or inside the ket. Okay. Right. So what I can do, maybe then I can briefly update my notation here. So UH is equal to chi H alpha, chi H alpha dot. Okay, I'm not obliged to report this alpha dot when I write the brackets, but I do it just for you to remember. And V bar H, which is V dagger H gamma zero. I will remind you tomorrow what are the gamma matrices, but you remember that gamma zero is off diagonal 2 by 2 with minus one here and there, right? And so this is chi H alpha, chi H alpha dot. While for the epsilon, for the polarization vector, epsilon H alpha alpha dot is square root of 2 over m, this tau, simple tensors, 1h, a1, a2, chi a1 alpha, chi a2 alpha dot. Sorry, I'm writing chi, but I shouldn't. Well, let's keep chi. Okay, we are 5 minutes to the end, so you may wonder how I can hope to get the wave function and polarization vectors for an arbitrary momentum, given that it took so much time to get to the one with momentum at rest. Okay. So in fact, it is possible because because of the following. So particle with arbitrary momentum p. Because a particle with an arbitrary momentum p is defined, okay, as a Lorentz transformation that acts on the particle state at rest. There are different definitions of this transformation, which bring to different definitions of particle states. So let me call this standard state, where one can employ different standards. So it is a Lorentz transformation, lambda standard, and which transformation it is, of course, it depends on the momentum you want the particle to acquire, acting on the state at rest. Okay? And that's also where the helicity, which means the same things always, that is to say, is the third component of the spin in the rest frame. So for this state, the helicity means third component of the spin. But well, when you go to the definition of the state going through this Lorentz transformation, what the helicity means in terms of operator, the operator it measures, can assume different forms. Can be the helicity in terms of the projection of the momentum of the spin on the momentum in one definition of the standard transformation. Can be something different if you use other definitions of the standard transformations. So, but let's first compute the wave function for generic state. Given that the state for generic momentum is the Lorentz transformation of the state at rest, I just have to act with the Lorentz transformation on the spinors that I just computed at rest. For example, if I had my spinor for the vial, then this is just equal to pH is just equal to u of lambda standard state at rest. Here I have psi, right, at zero, okay, at x equal to zero. So here I can insert u dagger. Okay, the identity written in terms of the U transformation times its inverse. The vacuum is Lorentz invariant, so I can drop this, right? And this becomes the action of the U operator on the psi state, U dagger psi U, which I know exactly what it is. It is lambda standard, the same transformation that I'm doing on the state, the same transformation explicitly matrix with component alpha beta, right, times the psi state, times psi beta at x equal to zero. Of course, this works just because I'm at x equal to zero. Otherwise, I will need to transform also x. Okay. And so from this, I just turn this matrix element into the matrix element between the vacuum and the state, and psi and the state at rest, which is the one I've computed before. So, here, in this case, I'm just going to get the standard Lorentz transformation, alpha beta, acting on VH beta, right? The same V defined up there, the same spinor defined up there. And that's going to be work the same way in all cases. In all cases, if you work them out, you do the lambda standard transformation, it simply amounts to take the V and replace it with lambda acting on V. Okay? So the result at the end for the spinors written on this blackboard, in fact, already assumes this step. That is to say, you just need to
Quesito.
You just need to replace V alpha A with chi alpha A. And V bar, in fact, will be just replaced with chi bar, and chi bar A alpha dot, it's related to the complex conjugate of chi by this equation, which is the same equation you had for the V. By taking really 2 minutes only I can write down for you two standard transformations that are useful choice if you want of coordinates. So the standard transformation that we do must be capable to bring us from the particle at rest to a particle with momentum p, right? So what are the valid standard transformation? Are those that are able to take the momentum matrix proportional to the identity, mi, the matrix at rest, and bring it to p. Bring it by Lorentz transformation, which is the way in which we said we know that the momentum is transformed as lambda dagger, right? So valid Lorentz transformation must be such that P is equal to lambda standard M identity, lambda standard dagger of P, which is just, of course, M lambda standard dagger. And whatever standard transformation you invent that fulfills this condition, it's a valid Lorentz transformation. It's a valid standard transformation. The two choices are taken here from two great papers. One is by Jacob and Wick, on the general theory of particle collisions with spin. And the other one is by D. E. Soper, which is an infinite momentum elicity states, and it's very interesting why it's called infinite momentum. What has to do with this, with the infinite momentum? It has to do also with some papers by Weinberg about electrodynamics in the infinite momentum frame. But so here, I just want to finish with these formulas. We will comment a bit again at the beginning. And if you have time this afternoon, you may want to check that these formulas at least obey that equation up there. I'm using spherical coordinates for for the particle free momentum. So theta and phi are spherical coordinates for the particle I'm considering free momentum, and omega plus minus are the square root of P0, sorry if it's small, plus or minus P3, okay? And so if I use this lambda standard transformation, chi plus or minus is gonna be equal to lambda times B plus minus, but B plus minus, unfortunately I erased them, but they were just 1, 0, 0, 1, times square root of m. They were just trivial vectors 1, 0, 0, 1, and so in fact this one, think, it's chi plus in the infinite, in the Jacobic representation. This other thing is chi minus. And the result, it's even simpler if you look at this infinite momentum frame ellicity thing, which I'm just gonna call it IF for you. It's 1 over square root of m. M over square root of p plus. In this case, I'm using light cone collider coordinates because they're more convenient to express, as you see, the result, square root of p plus 0 square root of p plus. So, and again, this one is chi plus, and this one other column here is chi minus. Okay, I want to almost strictly respect the time, so I will stop here and I will comment briefly on some implications at the beginning of next, of tomorrow lectures. Please. Because it's, so it's universal in the sense that if you do have, you have to compute a scattering amplitude of particle with dispersed spins, then you can always express the matrix element in terms of the contraction of these chi objects, rather than having to, if you want, to memorize and write down the always the so yeah, it's way more convenient. We will see, we will see tomorrow, how you can understand things by computing. It's more efficient. Yeah. Yeah, it's like, I think I view this as, in the first place, it's bookkeeping, okay? But you just need to record a few information about the particle. You just need to record the particle, write it somewhere else, and all this possible contraction with the other particles, and then you give to a computer the way to combine them to do a Feynman diagram. This will answer your question when we see some calculation. Please. Right. So the moment in which I define that the state under a rotation, so the moment I write this equation, right, G okay, I'm declaring exactly, okay, how so I'm declaring exactly what are these matrices, okay? So let me try to answer in this way. You can always make a transformation between different ellicities that then mess this up. And it's legitimate. You may decide to work also in SU2, in quantum mechanics. You may decide to represent a particle with things that are complicated linear combination that diagonalize not the spin 3, but other spins. So the way in which I specify that this is the spin tree is because these ones are not abstract generic matrices, but are really the spin S representation that you write on that you find on Wikipedia. So since in Wikipedia there is written that this matrix is diagonal, the third component of the spin here is diagonal in terms of eigenvalue H, that's where I decide that these states now are defined to have eigenvalue H that is equal to the spin. Okay? So if you want, I'm decided to work with the basis. So the fact that this is a representation of rotations is out of question. The fact that I'm representing this in terms of state that are eigenvalues of J3, of course, is my convention. It's the standard and useful convention. That? I don't think I concluded that the vector has spin one. So what I can, so. So if you look at this equation, okay, let's look it backwards. You see that this alpha and alpha dot, they are in the 2 and 2 bar representation. So under rotation, this is in the 2 times 2. 2 times 2 is 3 plus 1. Right? So this state, okay, can then have spin one because it's included in the representation that corresponds to this V. It cannot have spin one half, right? So what I just said is that there is an interpolating field, as you know very well, which is a spin one field. It's just written in a tensor notation here that can interpolate, that can destroy, in this case, from the vacuum, a particle with spin one. And we do normally use this field as an interpolating field for particles of spin one. By the way, we could have used a different field to interpolate for spin one.